Before we even begin this video, a simple but necessary clarification must be made. People very often confuse abiogenesis with evolution, when they shouldn't. Abiogenesis is the study of how life first emerged from non-living matter, and it's not discussed within this video. Evolution, on the other hand, is the study of biological change over time, and it is the star of this video. Now, with that said and out of the way, let's get on with the video. The evidence for evolution comes from every branch of science that remotely interacts with organisms. This includes, to name but a few, anatomy, biology, embryology, genetics, neurobiology, and paleontology, which in turn includes every subfield of these sciences, such as anthropology, biogeography, chronological dating, comparative anatomy, fossils, molecular biology, and the list goes on and on and on and on. The point being here is that everything we objectively know about the natural world both supports and improves the theory of evolution by natural selection, whether we like it or not. This is 9 proofs of evolution, why evolution is true. Now, to present all of the evidence for evolution would take eons and would bore even Darwin, Dawkins and Jay Gould. And so if you're really interested in reviewing all of the overwhelming evidence for evolution, then this video isn't it. What it is, however, is just 9 lines of evidence from several fields of study which by themselves alone make a very convincing case. So, where to begin? Well, the first 2 lines of evidence that I'm going to present both come from the comparative anatomy of whales to land mammals. We've long known that despite whales looking like fish, they're mammals, because just like mammals and unlike fish, they give birth to live young, feed their young milk via their mammary glands, breathe through 2 lungs rather than gills, have skin and hair rather than skin and scales, and they're warm-blooded. Now this alone strongly implies that they share a common ancestor with land mammals. But what really makes this suggestion even more compelling, and what I'll offer as a first line of evidence, is the curious bone structure of their flippers. Within their flippers, whales have, just like the forelimbs of land mammals, finger, hand, wrist, and arm bones, which can be easily explained if these bones are repurposed forelimbs, but are remarkably hard to explain if they're not. As after all, these bones have very little in common with non-mammalian fins, and yet a great deal in common with the forelimbs of land mammals. Furthermore, and to invoke a second line of evidence, whales have strange bones that look like shriveled hip, thigh, and shin bones where land mammals have hind legs. And some of these bones, such as these from a bonehead whale, even have what appears to be a ball and socket joint. Further still, paleontologists have found numerous species within the fossil record that have unique similarities with whales, but also varying sizes of hind legs. Now, once again, these bones make perfect sense if they're vestigial and/or repurposed, but they're very peculiar if they're not. Talking of vestigial traits, and to present a third line of evidence, a superb example can be found in all mammals, including you, and it's called the left recurrent laryngeal nerve. Without getting too technical, this nerve runs from the brain to the voice box, which should be a distance of a few inches. But instead, it goes down into the chest, loops around a main artery, and then goes back up to the voice box, which in the case of the giraffe results in a 15-foot detour. A mistake that no engineer would ever make. However, in animals without a neck, such as fish, the most direct route for this nerve is indeed by navigating around the artery. And hence, if mammals evolved from fish-like ancestors, we can easily explain why this absurd design exists. But if, on the other hand, we want to insist that it was deliberately created this way by a designer, then, well, we certainly can't call this designer intelligent. Now, the 4th and 5th lines of evidence that I'm going to present both come from DNA sequencing, which, for those of you unaware, is the process of determining the precise order of nucleotides within a DNA molecule, which put simply, means that we can compare the DNA of one organism to another, and in doing so, see exactly how closely related they are. Needless to say, by doing this, we have made many outstanding discoveries. But perhaps the most extraordinary, And what I offer as a fourth line of evidence is that all living things are related, and that therefore, all living things share a common ancestor. Seriously, of the DNA that is comparable, you share 97% with a chimpanzee, 80% with a cow, 60% with a fruit fly, and 50% with a banana. Now, most of us have heard this fact before and treated it like it's just a bit of trivia, including myself, but it's far more than this. It's unimpeachable proof that all living things share a common ancestor. And considering that all living things don't look the same, it's overwhelming evidence for evolution. And the second line of evidence from DNA that I'll present, and the fifth within this video, is that the closest living relative to cetaceans, which is a class that includes whales, is the hippopotamus, a land mammal that just so happens to share many very rare commonalities with cetaceans. For example, both mammals are nearly hairless, do not have sweat glands, have remarkably thick bones, are encased in dense fat, have multi-chambered stomachs, give birth to their young underwater, feed their young underwater, and communicate with their kin underwater. Now, all of these similarities once again make perfect sense if cetaceans and hippos share a common ancestor, as their DNA screams, let alone suggests. But if they didn't evolve from a common ancestor, then all of these similarities are one hell of a coincidence, and DNA is the greatest troll in history. The sixth line of evidence that I'll present is the artificial selection of domestic dogs. It's no secret that most breeds of dog have the specific traits that they do because humans have deliberately, or artificially, selected which dogs get to reproduce, and in doing so, which traits are passed on to subsequent generations. For example, greyhounds have powerful legs, deep chests, flexible spines, and slim builds because humans have deliberately bred dogs with these attributes. The same is true of the tiny height of chihuahuas. They are the result of humans breeding smaller and smaller dogs. And the same is also true of the giant height of Great Danes. They are the result of humans breeding bigger and bigger dogs. It may not seem like it, but domestic dog breeds alone not only suggest evolution, they demonstrate it. Now, as we've just explained, the selective pressure in the case of domestic dog breeds is artificial. It's humans deliberately selecting which dogs get to reproduce. But this raises the immediate question of what exactly selects which organisms get to reproduce in nature. And the answer is nature. To further explain this, and to give you a few fascinating examples, I'm going to have Thomas from Holy Koolaid jump in. Enjoy.
This first example is a bit of a celebrity in the world of evolutionary biology, the peppered moth. During the Industrial Revolution, coal plants dumped out enough air pollution to kill the light-colored algae on trees and coat the foliage with soot. The light gray moths, which once blended in against the bark of the trees, were now exposed and were picked off by birds and other predators, but a small percent of the population had a rare genetic mutation that led to dark-colored wings. This beneficial mutation gave them a survival advantage, allowing them to camouflage in with their changing environment. Before long, the majority of the peppered moth population were the darker variety, but in the 1950s, clean energy reform reversed this trend, causing the dark moths to be more vulnerable, leading to a resurgence in the lighter-colored moths, who were still the dominant variety in the less polluted countryside. Now that genome sequencing has become available and affordable for scientists, researchers at the University of Liverpool have pinpointed the exact mutation that caused the color change. Another excellent example of evolution in action is the silent crickets of Hawaii. To attract a mate, male crickets on the island of Kauai would rub their wings together to create a chirping noise. Several years ago, a parasitic fly entered their ecosystem, honing in on the noisy crickets and laying larvae inside of them that would eat them from the inside out. A rare mutation on the X chromosome caused some crickets to develop without the ridges on their wings required to chirp. Natural selection did its thing, and within just 20 generations, 95% of the crickets on the island were silent. When the flies migrated to Oahu a few years later, the crickets there independently underwent the same life-saving evolutionary change via a different mutation. Now, that's all fine and dandy, creationists might argue, but those are all examples of microevolution, not macroevolution. Animals never change species or reproduce outside their kind. Which brings us to ring species. For this, we'll take a look at the greenish warbler of the Himalayas, which biologists believe migrated south to north, branching east and west around the mountains. As time passed, they evolved and adapted to their new environments, but by the time they met met up north of the Himalayas, they were so different that they were no longer able to interbreed. Each bird reproduced with its southern neighbors all the way back around the loop, but they couldn't reproduce with each other. A textbook example of evolution in progress, if I've ever seen one.
Thanks for those brilliant examples, Thomas. As always, you're on form, sir. Now, I assume that many of you already knew who Thomas was before seeing this video, but for those of you who didn't, I implore you to check out his wonderful content. He's a remarkably talented creator and a true asset of Rationality. And when you inevitably decide to subscribe to him, do me a favour and let him know who sent you. Anyhow, before I go, I've got another treat for you, and it also includes Thomas. In fact, it stars Thomas. If you click on this link, you'll be taken to his channel to see the counterpart of this video, titled 10 Misconceptions About Evolution, and within it you'll see both Thomas and I go to town on these aggravatingly ignorant misconceptions. And so, my fellow apes, what are you waiting for? Click the link and join me over there. You'll be pleased that you did. Oh, and as always, thank you kindly for the view.